My name is Ekant Veer. I'm here to talk to you about this topic. Can marketing actually be good for society? Marketing. I have a very interesting, weird background. I was born in the UK. I was brought up in the UK, moved to New Zealand when I was 15, and then bounced between the UK and New Zealand ever since. While I was in New Zealand, I met my wonderful wife during undergrad. And as you do, you go to the colonies, get yourself a wife, and go back. And so we did that. And then realized that, no, UK wasn't actually for us, so we had a second baby over in the UK and brought her back here. And yeah, I dragged my family around the world a bit too much. But in about 2002, 2003, both my wife and I were living and working in Auckland, and my wife's an accountant, a chartered accountant, and she was an auditor at the time, and she had the same sort of feeling I had. I was working for a large corporate marketing company, both of us making a lot of money for people who already had a lot of money. And my wife was getting to this point where it says, I'm working with companies that are profiting off people making money out of other people suffering, offering unmanageable amounts of debt to people, subprime loans, that sort of thing. While here I am making money off trying to sell stuff to people who don't really need stuff or don't have money to buy stuff or don't have the ability to try and combat that. So I quit my reasonably lucrative job at the time and went back to university to do my PhD, find myself, and that sort of thing. And I had a sugar mama to support me while I was doing that. So being a chartered accountant, even as disillusioned as she was able to support me during that period. Roles have switched since. I looked at how we can use marketing to benefit society. My wife now has left the chartered accounting world. She works for a company in Christchurch called Kingdom Resources. And she's the community education coordinator for them. And so she goes around teaching people how to manage their money, teaches people how to do budgets, teaches people how to actually make the most of the money they have, and as a result, try and avoid unmanageable amounts of debt. So here I am at the University of Canterbury writing about how to make lives better. My wife's actually on the streets making people's lives better. I get paid too much to work too little. She gets paid too little to work too much. She's actually making a difference. I sit at my computer and think, this might work. So we together balance out to a reasonably average human being, I think, both of whom are trying to make the world a better place. And that's what we're really going to talk about tonight. So as Phil said, who am I? I joined in 2010, just in time for the September quakes, which was great fortune. Paul, who is my boss, is here. He hired me from the UK to come and work for him. He did not tell me about the earthquakes at the time. So we were actually just going to auction the week of the September quake, so it was great timing for us. Most of the work I do focuses on marketing, how marketing can be used to understand people and how to make their lives better. I'm the current editor-in-chief for a journal called the Journal of Research for Consumers. And this is a journal that's very much focused on not just academic rigor, but also making sure that the work we do as academics is accessible back to the people who need it most. And I'll talk about that more as time goes on. I'm also a regular ranter and tweeter on these sort of handles. If you're a social media user, feel free to abuse me on social media tonight. I'm one of these people that I like to stir things up a little bit. So if you want to tweet me something along the lines of, oh my God, Ekant, what are you doing? Why have you said that? That sort of thing. Stir things up, make my boss a little nervous. That's fine. Cool. So what do? I look at consumption. I look at how and why people make the decisions they do. I look at how and why people buy the things they do. I look at how and why people use the things they do and in the way they do it. I look at why people make decisions that they do and what motivates them to make those decisions. Now, I have the opportunity to use that for good or for evil. And I have sometimes wanted to switch on the other side. Sometimes it seems much easier to see if we can make an extra 10% for a large corporation. See if we can make them more profit, slip me a couple of percent here and there, and I'll be a very happy person. But in reality, I gave up that life so that we can try and make people's lives better. So how do we do this? And this is what the topic of tonight's talk is. It's going to be about how we can use marketing, consumer research, psychology, to try and improve people's lives, improve welfare as best we can, rather than try and get money out of their pocket. Now, I'm not saying consumption is bad, okay? I'm not encouraging you all to go out into the woods and start a community and live off the grid or anything like that. There is always balance in everything we do. I wish I could sit here and stand here and talk about all the needs everybody in this room has. I know we've got budget advisors. I know we've got people working with mental health. I know we've got people working sustainability. I'm not going to be able to address every single issue in my short talk. We'll be done by 7:30. But I do encourage you to ask questions at the end. Try and tap my brain, see if I can give you an answer to that. Now, if we still don't have time once we get kicked out of here, then I will be more than happy for you to buy me a drink at the Foundry and we will discuss this further, okay? Before I get into the actual talk as well, I should say, and I didn't say, that in the event of an unforeseen circumstance, please see the exits both to the side and at the back. Remember that the nearest exit might be behind you. Count the rows to that exit. If there's something happens, if there's a shake, wait for instructions. If you need to brace yourself, brace yourself. If you're in doubt, follow the locals. Okay, they know what to do. I usually say I don't get out of bed for less than 5.5. But in the case of an emergency, we'll make ourselves quietly out to the car park out the side, and we'll wait there for further instructions. Cool. Apologies. Should have said that at the start. So, what is marketing? Marketing has a number of definitions. I like to use this very simple definition, and it always starts with understanding consumers. Marketing is about understanding consumers' needs and wants. Not everything we do is a need. We need clothing. We need food. We need water. We need air. We need those basics of life and civility. We don't need to have the latest fashions, as you can see. We don't need to have excess amounts of food. I am learning that. We don't need to have excess amounts of drink. I'm trying to keep hydrated. Like I said, buy me a drink at the Foundry, we'll keep more hydrated. It's good for us. From understanding needs and wants, we go on to seeing if we can provide a solution to those needs and wants. How can we solve people's needs and wants? How can we create something that will make people's lives better? Whether it is by selling them the latest fashion and making them feel cool about themselves, or whether it's about finding some way to encourage them to behave in a manner that will benefit them and benefit society. And the final point, which sometimes gets missed, is we need to do this better than our competitor or our competitors. How can we create something, make sure that consumers want it, need it, and then how can we do that better than our competitors? Now, unfortunately, in the sort of stuff that I do, when I'm talking about health, when I'm talking about exercise, when I'm talking about eating, whatever it might be, the competitors aren't necessarily direct competitors. People like if you're working for Mars Bar, then your direct competitor might be someone selling another chocolate bar, okay? With us, when you're talking about exercise, when you're talking about breaking down stigmas or breaking down prejudices, your competitor might be culture. Your competitor might be lifestyle. Your competitor might be time or inclination, much harder things to try and break down. So how can we do that as marketers? How can we try and encourage people to do the right thing, and do it better than what their competitor is, sometimes mindset or anything like that? Question?
One of the things that I see missing there is stimulating needs and wants.
I don't think we need stimulating needs and wants. I think there's a lot of consumers who do things that necessarily aren't stimulating. My wife is here, so I'll have to think of a different example. Needs and wants can often be value-driven. They can often be there to try and improve our lives or whatever it might be. Sometimes people do things just for the heck of it. Okay? Sometimes that's to generate fun or anything like that. You can have stimulating as part of it. I don't think it's necessary, though. People have needs and wants. Now, marketers are sometimes the problem. And sometimes marketers have a lot to blame for the things. Now, marketers can stimulate needs and wants. Is that what you're saying? That's right. So marketers can often be the ones that create needs and wants. And I'll try and show a video. I had embedded a bunch of videos into my presentation. Fortunately, they hadn't loaded up correctly. So we'll try and swap backs and forwards between the internet and this. And hopefully it'll work. But there will be occasions when marketers will create a need and want. This is an image that I sometimes use. Materialism, spending money you don't have on crap you don't need. Okay, sums up how some people see their life or how marketers can make them feel they need their life. I know there was an earthquake, I think it was the 2012 June earthquakes. I was home alone, my family were up in Tauranga visiting the in-laws, and there was a big shake, and so I ran over and I held the TV. Protect the TV. And I thought, that's a stupid idea, what the heck? I shouldn't be covering. And then it started wobbling, and I thought, maybe I should just throw it over because I could use a bigger TV. No, what am I thinking? You know, So the TV stayed safe. I stayed very unsafe while I was protecting my TV, okay? But this is the sort of mindset that materialism created. So what do? I do this thing called social marketing. And social marketing is this way of using what corporate marketers use to try and sell products, what corporate marketers use to try and make money out of us, and I try to use it in a way that will hopefully make people's lives better. Now, I should start off by saying social marketing has got nothing to do with Facebook, Twitter, or Bebo, and everything else like that. Social marketing as a concept has been around for about 50, 60 years. Social media marketing turned up when Zuckerberg created a little website, and we started to do that. So it's nothing to do with that. However, I will talk a little bit about my role in social media and how I use social media in my research. Social marketing seems simple. It seems like an easy way just to adapt what we do to try and encourage people to behave in a responsible way or whatever it might be. But the question was asked in 1955, why can't we sell brotherhood the same way we sell soap? What are the factors that make it more difficult to encourage people to act in a responsible, good way that benefits society compared to just get someone to purchase a product? Now, a lot of the reason comes down to jealousy or just wanting something. People want something that other people have. So a lot of the problem sometimes comes down to people actually are a bit selfish. Sometimes the problem just comes down to people don't know what they actually want. I do a lot of work with kids, and when you go to a kid and say, hey, don't smoke because in 60 years' time you might have bad health, they don't care. When you go to a teenager and say, hey, you shouldn't drive fast because you might die in a crash, they'll say, you know what, that's because those people that die are bad drivers. I'm a good driver. I have had the great situation where I talk to people who are alcoholics, and they say, I actually drive better when I'm drunk. Why do they drive better when they're drunk? Because I'm actually concentrating. Otherwise, I'm looking all over the place. But when I'm drunk, I'm really focused. Genius, okay? We have a lot of things that we need to break down in the role of social marketing in order to try and understand how we can encourage people to behave in a socially responsible way. Now, I keep doing this because after doing this for many years, you tend to learn that I don't have the answers. I don't get to dictate what is right and wrong. Even the government doesn't get to dictate what is right and wrong. There are certainly inherent right and wrong things to do and ways that we operate in a society, but it doesn't mean that we should judge other people, and we'll talk about that as time goes on. I want to show you this example of an ad. Like I said, I was meant to have these all embedded. And this is an ad, I think, that carefully and accurately depicts the sort of work that I do.
I'm in here. Can anybody see me? Can anybody hear? I'm in here, a prisoner of history. Can anybody
I think he's choking.
You need to try and calm down.
Okay, can you just think? How long are they going
to
be?
They'll be here in 5 minutes.
They need to be here now.
Isn't that the thing where you just push him off?
I don't know. I don't know. Oh my God. Do something.
So, a very simple ad. Very simple ad with a very simple message, that First Aid is able to save 140,000 people in the UK where this ad was set, the same number of people that die of cancer every year. We have a strong awareness of cancer and how evil it is and how horrible it is, more so in New Zealand where there's a huge prevalence of cancers. What we don't think about is things like First Aid. Let me give you a personal example. I was driving home from a concert in Auckland when I was doing my undergrad, driving home with a bunch of friends, and we drove past a car crash while we were driving home. And all of us in the car said, if we were the first people to be on that scene, if we were the car that saw that crash, would any of us know what to do? None of us did. So what do? A few of us signed up for a first aid course the next week, and we went through a first aid course. Most of us know that the things that encourage us to make a change for the positive usually involve some sort of personal affliction, something that is personal to us, something that is meaningful to us. And this is why mass advertising campaigns sometimes miss the mark. Something like this can try and take something that, when you say, oh, have you done a first aid course? Many people, well, I know CPR, I know the basics sort of thing, but have you actually done a first aid course? Did you know that as many people as 140,000, same number of people who die from cancer, could be saved if everyone knew first aid? That sort of thing starts making people make it more personal. They realize how powerful it can be. Okay, so that's a very simple example. I like that one because it doesn't rely so much on the gore and the shock that you sometimes see when it comes to public service advertising and public service announcements. New Zealand seems to have this affinity for seeing people flown apart or flying out of cars or dying in horrific ways. And we'll talk about maybe why that is. But something like that I find a little bit more powerful. You're not expecting it. It's a bit of a shock, but it's not gory. Let me give you another quick example, and this is based on some research that I've just got the data back in the last couple of weeks. I'm still crunching the numbers, but I thought I'd present some preliminary information. This was some data that was collected alongside my master's student, Sarah, who's here. Sarah's been helping me with this last year, and we've been going through this. Let's pretend you have some money. Let's pretend you want to invest that money. Let's pretend you're flicking through an investment magazine and you see an ad like this. Can I please say right now as a public service announcement, never invest with anything called Ekant Invest. You will lose your money, okay? But I started off with a very simple ad like this, and we told people, you've got about $10,000, you're looking to invest it in a company, here's some investment information, here's a magazine with some investment information. And I slipped this ad into one of those pages. And it was Ekant Invest. I changed the name, it's obviously not Ekant Invest, that would be a silly name. And I put Invest with us, and showed this to half the people. The other half the people saw this ad that said, play the market with us, okay? Now, play the market is a term we use. It's a term we use when we're talking about stocks and shares, but it suddenly changes the tone a little bit, just with a couple of words. Now, when I changed it to gamble with us for the last group, suddenly people's opinions changed. Now, people never saw two of these ads. They just saw one of these ads. And you can probably imagine what happened. But when we know, and economists have shown us, that playing the market is as good as gambling, that random number generators are actually able to do better than some stockbrokers out there, then it is really gambling sometimes when you put money into these things. You kind of hope and you kind of look for guarantees, but it is gambling. So what did we find? Very simply, the people who saw the invest with us, you know, 55, 56% of people were quite okay with considering them as a potential for investing with them. When it came to play, it dropped quite a bit. When it came to gamble, no way. They want nothing to do with it. Pretty simple example, nothing too major. Let's change it. We all know who this is. We all know Lotto. We all know Lotto. Lotto is a big part of New Zealand. It's a big part of New Zealand culture now. It's been around for many years. You go to any Lotto shop, and you will see this term, play here. Go to Riccarton, it'll say play here. Go to your dairy, it'll say play here. What if we changed it to gamble here? It's essentially the same thing. It is a gamble. If anything, we know that playing Lotto is more of a gamble than investing in stocks and shares. We know Lotto is gambling. So what do you think the results would be here? Pretty simple again. If you showed play versus gamble, people who saw play, we said, here's 10 bucks, do you want to go and play Lotto? Yeah, most people said, yeah, I would consider that as being something that I would want to do, play Lotto. When we said gamble, it dropped. Now, that's not big news. We know that the word can change things. What if we change it up a little bit? We created this little game, an online game, where people played this online pokey game, and the thing spun round, and you had to try and invest a fake $100 that we gave them, and see if you can make as much money as you can off this pokies in 5 minutes. The people who designed this actually made it so the jackpot was 3 Ekant faces. And I said, you have to understand, no one will believe that's a jackpot, okay? So we changed that. So, and we rigged the game. Me being a marketer, me being nasty, I rigged the game so that half the people who did this game were naturally going to lose. No matter what they did, the probability of them winning was much smaller, the probability of them losing money much, much higher. And we had half who were going on a winning streak. So we've got half who are on a losing streak, half who are on a winning streak. We then presented this thing saying, you've got 10 bucks left. Would you like to go and play Lotto or gamble with Lotto? Simple experiment. When we look at the people who are shown the gamble word, it doesn't matter if they're on a losing streak or a winning streak, they were pretty much the same. They had the same likelihood of spending their last 10 bucks on that money. So around 30, 35% sort of thing. Well, so the winning streak, about 40%, but that difference wasn't significant. No difference. Now, those people on a losing streak, though, versus a winning streak, when you use the word play, changed significantly. So people who are on a winning streak and they saw the word play not only wanted to gamble a lot more, play a lot more than the people who saw the gamble word, but also they were more willing to put that money down compared to people who saw the gamble word, who are on a losing streak, okay? Winning play word on the winning streak. Now again, we're able to show that the person's motivations, what they've experienced in the past, has led them to be influenced by just one word, gamble or play. In this case, if you're on a losing streak, using the word play is going to encourage you to bet a little bit more. But when you come on a winning streak, much, much more. Okay? More likely to put that 10 bucks down. I'm a winner. I know I'm winning. I reckon I've got a shot at this. It's a lucky streak. I'm going to do it. Even though the probability of winning Lotto has not changed. The thing you've just done has no influence on that impact or Lotto. But internally, we know that maybe we're going to get lucky today. Today's the day I'm going to win the millions. Again, not that exciting. What if we changed it up a little bit more? We repeated the last experiment, and we had a personal winning streak. They played the game again. They actually won some money. They were actually feeling like they're on a lucky streak. The other group of people, we put on a third-party winning streak. They didn't actually play any games. They read an article about someone else who'd won. They read an article about someone who'd won Lotto, someone whose life had changed. Someone who has made their way now because Lotto had driven them out of the doldrums of their life. And then we showed them, do you want to play or do you want to gamble? As to be expected, people who play, got the word play, personal winning streak didn't change from the last experiment, but even seeing someone else winning, even seeing someone else's life changed, you use the word play and suddenly they're excited to put that 10 bucks down. They wanted to win as well. They wanted to see that. And they had not experienced winning themselves. They just heard of someone else winning. Over here, the gamble word, when they're on a personal winning streak, that was the same as before. I'm still okay. Maybe I'll put a little bit down. But I'm winning, but maybe I should cut my losses here, cut my winnings here, and just go home while I'm a winner. Some people said, you know, what the heck? I'm on a streak. Let's try it. Let's, even if it's a gamble, I'll try it. If you saw a third-party winning streak, someone else won, people were reporting things like, well, they gambled and they won. I'm not willing to make that gamble. I'll take the 10 bucks. They did this and they won, but it's too much of a gamble for me. That word gamble became salient. Now, why am I telling you this? Why should I care about this? Why should we care about this word? Because the word play is influencing how much money is being spent at Lotto. More people, as a result of this, are inclined to spend money at Lotto based on both their experiences. Like they might feel like they're a winner, and they might think this is going to happen. Or they've seen other people winning. And we know there are shows on TV dedicated to watching people who've won at Lotto and how their lives have changed. Now, beyond that, Lotto has turned into a game show. You've got the big wheel that you can spin, and you can see the person win, and their lives have changed, and they get the confetti coming down, and everything's wonderful and magical. That is play, and it is third-party winning. It creates that effect. We've turned Lotto on Saturday and a Wednesday, whatever it might be, into a show, into a game, into a way of play. And that's influencing people to gamble. Very simple experiment, which has a powerful repercussion. So what should we do with this sort of thing? Okay? What do we do with this research? We do with it, we try to use it to influence policy. This is another example. This is a piece of research that was published in the European Journal of Marketing, and it was done with a colleague of mine, Ilda Bekrovic. Does anybody know who these women are? Yeah, Kate Winslet used to be famous. She was on a ship or something. So this is Kate Winslet. Anyone know who she is? Good. She's not meant to be famous. Okay. So she's meant to be just someone that we found that when we pre-tested these experiments was seen to be as attractive as Kate Winslet, but not a famous. But she kind of looks like Natalie Imbruglia, so that's okay, not famous. So we had two people. One person a celebrity, one person a non-celebrity. And we put a very simple tagline against these women. Half the people saw Kate Winslet and this tagline, the other half saw the non-celebrity attractive lady and the tagline. And the tagline, this was done in the UK, so you'll understand, is I vote conservative, do you? Simple as that. Very simple experiment. Who thinks that Kate would be more effective in encouraging people to vote conservative? Hands up. Who thinks Natalie Imbruglia, a non-famous person, would be more... Who is not putting... There's about 80% that's not putting your hand up. The people who didn't put their hand up are right, because it depends. It depends. Neither produced themselves as being more effective than the other because there was something else underlying it. There was something else, and this is the problem with social marketing, is people go, we should use celebrities because celebrities get people to do things, but no, that's not true. Celebrities only are effective in certain situations, and we were able to show this in this paper. So the dotted line here is Kate Winslet. Not literally. Represents Kate Winslet. And the flat line here is the non-celebrity. So we had this thing called political salience. Political salience referred to how important policies and politics is to you as a person. How important is the actual politics associated with the Conservative Party to you? Now, with the non-celebrity, it did not really matter if you were politically minded or you didn't care about politics. They were pretty much the same. Now, if you did not care about politics, it wasn't important to you, and you saw the celebrity, whoa! You're winning. She votes for Conservative. I don't care about policies. I'm going to vote because Kate Winslet is someone I want to support. I'm voting for her. Well, not really her, but who she supports. Now, if you did care about politics, you were engaged with the policies associated with politics. You're engaged with the people who are running the country rather than the personalities that are running the country. You hated Kate Winslet. Absolutely despised the idea. I don't need a celebrity to tell me what to do, blah, 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 blah. Now, I was very cheeky and said, this gives credence to why in the US so many celebrities are being used, because no one really understands politics over there, okay? This is why whoever George Clooney votes for is who I vote for, or whoever Arnie votes for, that's what I'm... I got into trouble for saying that, but anyway. Okay, it still is in the paper, somewhere buried in there. So you've got this effect here, which is significant, and you've got this effect here, which is significant, this interaction effect, which is significant. Again, why should we care about this? Because using celebrities as a means of promoting your cause isn't necessarily the best answer all the time. Just because Richie McCaw is going to say yes to your cause doesn't make it going effective. What will make it effective is understanding your consumers first, understanding what their notions and understanding of your thing is, whether it's politics or disabilities or whatever, and then deciding whether you need to have a non-celebrity, everyday person people can relate to, or whether you should have a celebrity that you want to aspire to be like. Again, why should we talk about this? We talk about this because we have ads like this. Because you have ads like this by Stacey Jones encouraging instant finance. I don't know Stacey Jones, I've never met him. He's a phenomenal football player and I'm sure a really nice guy. But I think he made a mistake supporting instant finance because instant finance is a finance company that preys on people that have low financial salience. People who don't understand finances, people who don't understand debt, people don't understand how to get themselves out of debt. In which case, if we go back, perfect place for a celebrity. Great use of the research I do for evil. Okay? We also have situations where we can distract people, make the salience of a subject so low because they're thinking of something else, and then bombard them with advertising. This is a singing competition or a miming competition, or I don't know. This is the X Factor. Great work by the singers. Wonderful. Great show. What we don't see is the coke. When you suppress any notions of eating healthy, exercising, all those things, because you're in a situation that's about singing, a situation about let's have some entertainment, then having a Coke ad like that is going to have a similar effect that I showed with Kate Winslet. People are going to be more attracted to something like that. Now, the X Factor is very carefully set up to make sure that those subtle influences actually have an effect. Now, I'm not talking about subliminal advertising. I'm not talking about trying to slip it into your mind without you realizing. This is very conscious. People see this. We know subliminal advertising now is a bit crap. It doesn't really work. However, using this sort of product placement, especially in situations where your salience is switched off because you know not thinking about how I should drink healthily, whatever it might be, it does have an effect. What are some other examples? Now, John Kerwin's an example here when it comes to depression that I think does work. Because our understanding associated with depression, mental health, those sorts of things are quite low. Our salience is reasonably low. We don't have a full understanding all the time about it. So using celebrity in this sort of situation, I've lost someone already, in this sort of situation is probably appropriate. Okay? Using that celebrity to try and understand how we can increase even just awareness of the situations and encourage people to talk about it makes sense. And I will talk a little bit more about that in a second. So why does social marketing fail in my mind? Social marketing fails because we forsake impact for creativity. Sometimes we're looking for the coolest idea that sometimes we think maybe we should take a step back. Maybe we should just find out what people care about, find out what people are motivated by, and how can we use that to try and make their lives better. Rather than bombarding people with cool graphics or great websites or anything, sometimes sitting down and holding their hand through a situation might work better. Okay? Sometimes we forget that people are different. Now, unfortunately, and this is my next point, think that people are lazy and busy, and we're up against massive competition. We forget that people are different, and sometimes we have to have a huge bang for our buck. We need to try and reach as many people as possible. We have limited budgets, and so we put out this mass campaign that can make people's lives better, but at the same time can affect people's lives negatively as well. We forget that people are lazy or busy. Some people don't want to change or don't know how to change, or they don't care about changing. I won't ask. I usually ask in my class how many people are smokers, but I won't ask here. But I don't think there's a smoker alive who does not realize that smoking is bad for their health. Every smoker knows that it's probably affecting them. They just don't care. Okay? They don't care to change because they don't want to change, or there are other reasons they don't wish to change. But most of them know it's bad for the health. So when we bombard them with health messages, surely that's not effective. They know it's bad for the health, but they carry on smoking. So maybe we need to take a step back and find out what does motivate them. Let me give you another example from some research I did in the UK. I was called into a few schools, high schools, in the areas we were living in Bath. And they had a huge problem with kids in the high school smoking. 13 to 16-year-olds in particular picked up smoking very, very rapidly. How are we going to combat this? We don't really know. Now, I did a stupid thing, and I talked to the kids. Really, I don't know why I was thinking that. None of the theory says talk to people. So I talked to the kids and say, you know, what's going on? What's going on in your life? A lot of them reported that they were in transitionary phase. We know 13 to 16-year-olds transitioning from children to adults. But also that they didn't feel like they had any control. They didn't have any ability to express themselves as individuals. And this was their way of looking adult, of being cool, and being able to do something for themselves. They hated their parents telling them what to do. They hated being controlled by their parents. They hated being felt like they were gullible and they weren't smart enough to make their own decisions. So they're going to do something that benefits them. So we created some ads which showed all the bad things to do with smoking. It'll cause cirrhosis of the liver, you know, lung disease, blah, blah, blah. You know, make your breath bad. All these things that are horrible for children to do. And we showed half the people in the schools that ad. The other half, I created an ad which was full of quotes from tobacco executives basically lying, and barefaced lies. Things like a panel of tobacco executives at a court saying nicotine isn't addictive, cigarettes aren't addictive, no evidence says cigarettes are bad for you, blah, 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 blah. One tobacco executive, favorite quote, saying, yes, it's true that babies born to a smoking mother are smaller, but some women want smaller children. Genius. Genius. And so we put that ad in. All these quotes that these people have said, video footage of them. And we kept playing it back. And the end is, every time you smoke, you believe their lies. Don't be that gullible. Smoking was killed in those schools very quickly. Because the kids suddenly realized, I don't want to be lied to. I don't want to be seen as gullible. I don't want to be seen. I want to be able to make my own decision. Now, I didn't go back and tell them, hey, you guys are so gullible, you believed these things that I made you quit smoking with. That would be wrong of me, because you'll probably counter it and they go back to smoking. However, to find out how we can impact people and make their lives better was very simple. We had to start with talking to them, and I'll talk about that in a second with TCR. We're up against massive competition, not just from multinationals, not just from huge corporates with massive budgets. We're talking about things that make our lives harder. I know I should lose more weight. I'm in my 30s now. It's going to be harder for me to lose weight. It's going to be harder for me to get rid of this, which is going to cause diabetes down the line. But I could spend an hour at the gym or an hour with my kids. That's very difficult for me to argue. Sorry, kids, daddy wants to go to the gym. Because in 20 years' time, maybe I'll have more quality time with you. I don't want that, my kids to go, daddy's not here because he's at the gym. The reality is I wouldn't spend an hour at the gym. That's just silly. So, that was a good workout. The pub's open. So I do other things. So at the moment, I am being challenged to do the 30-day ab challenge by one of my former students. And I'm up to day 14, 65 sit-ups, 33 leg raises, 55 crunches, and a 42-second plank. I'm dying inside. My core is ripped to shreds. This is not making me stronger in my mind, but I'm going to stick it out because I'm stubborn, because my student knew I was stubborn. She knew that if she challenged me, I would do it. And so I'm doing it because that's what motivates me, okay? My students are looking at me going, I bet you can't give me an A. No, all right. So what is TCR? I am also part of this movement called Transformative Consumer Research. It's a very academic term for what should be common sense. And transformative consumer research is a way of doing research. So social marketing is taking commercial marketing technologies and applying them in a social area. TCR is more about using our research in a way that is more effective to meeting people's needs. We want to focus on people we want to help, not ourselves. We focus on the people we're trying to help, not our own careers or publishing, whatever it might be. And we focus on a person's life better, making a person's life better. I won't show this ad because we're running short on time, but maybe I'll show it later. How do you start with transformative consumer research? Whether you're an academic or not, you want to know your consumers' needs. You want to know your target population's need. So start by listening to what people care about. Understanding their needs and wants based on what they care about, making our work relevant to those people, finding a solution that improves their welfare, and then this last bit, which is way down the list, telling them about it. Sometimes, especially as academics, we forget to tell people about it. We go into a population, we rape and pillage them for data, we walk away, we publish in a fancy journal, and we forget about them. And that's wrong. We need to make sure that the work we're doing, if it can improve their lives, make sure we go back to them and tell them that it's improving their lives. So my role as a researcher is not just about understanding new things, but disseminating that back, not just through class, but through community engagement and the like. The journal that I edit has two sides to it. The Journal of Research for Consumers has academic side, and you publish your academic 30-page article, which is very academic-y. But every academic article that's published has to come with a layperson abstract, which is called the consumer article. And it's published alongside it, so that a layperson can look at it and say, I want to know more about heart disease. I want to know about combating alcohol violence. I want to know more about combating domestic violence, whatever it might be. They don't have to try and decipher the academic article. There is a layperson article associated with it. Very simple way of trying to encourage people to understand the work we do. I'm a big fan of making my work as relevant as possible, hence why we're here. So how do you actually do this? How do you actually get to know people? I like to walk in people's shoes. I like to see what they care about. I want to understand what they are talking about in their daily lives. I want to walk a mile in their shoes, if you want to use a Harper Lee expression. And the person may be hidden. We're talking about situations, context. We're talking about lives that people maybe feel stigmatized and marginalized about. They don't want to tell everyone, hi, I suffer from this, and hi, look at me. Some people do. And there might be underlying reasons for that as well. but most people don't like to promote the fact that maybe they're not as strong as they should be. Now, this is where my work in social media can help. I'm not saying social media is the only way. It is one way of trying to understand the real self. Many authors, many academics out there will say that we present our real self online. Who we really are is who we present when you're on Facebook, when you're on Twitter. Okay? And I think with most general situations, that would be true. If you're talking about something everyday, innocuous, perfectly fine. Now, some of us might have a stigmatized self, a side of ourselves that maybe we don't want the public to see. So I'm more a fan of saying that we have multiple selves and we present those multiple selves in different forms in different ways. So we have our personal self that we present to our friends and family. I have worn a lovely bright shirt. The university has told me I need to wear more bright shirts instead of the grays and blacks that I usually wear. I feel extremely uncomfortable because I think it's a little pink. Okay? But I'm wearing this because this is the public self. I will go home, I will put my comfy pants on, I'll make my way through a bag of chips, and I will watch TV, and that is my private self. My wife's a lucky gal. I'll then go online, and I might say something or tweet something that might be different again. Now, I study a group of people who hide who they really are, because for one reason or another, they don't feel they can express who they really are in their everyday offline world. They hide that, so they look for a forum online in order to express it. And I'm looking at men who suffer from mental illness, men who suffer from either bipolar or depression usually. And they suffer from this, and they don't feel they can express it to their friends and family because of this dichotomy between masculinity and weakness that exists in our culture. And you cannot be depressed as a man because you're a man, you're strong, you must be in charge, you must be in control. So how dare you think that you can be depressed? How dare you show weakness? So a lot of these men feel constrained about their ability to actually express themselves. I've been studying this formally for maybe about a year or so, not very long. I've been studying this informally for maybe about 15, 16 years since I was diagnosed with depression. I've lived more of my life with depression than without depression, which in itself is a depressing thought. But I'm able to control it. I'm able to understand it. I'm able to control the beast. A lot of these men aren't, because they can't even reach out and look for help because none of them actually want to tell anyone that they are suffering with this. So what these men have done is anonymously communicate their thoughts and feelings online through different blogs, fora, videos sometimes where they anonymize themselves, whatever it might be, simply looking for other people to support them because they can't talk to their wife or their partner about it, they can't talk to their friends and family about it, so they don't want to be seen as weak. Now, TCR would say we need to take a person-centric approach to this. How can we understand the person? So I went onto these blogs, and I listened to what they had to say. I didn't interact with them. I didn't change anything about the forums. I just listened to what they had to say. And here's a few quotes. I'm not sad. I feel nothing. I'm numb. I'm scared, and I can't tell anyone that I'm scared. I don't need you to fix me. I need you to stand by me. Men don't suffer from depression because men aren't allowed to be weak. I'm not looking for a cure. I'm looking for a voice. The hardest three words for a man to say aren't I love you, they're I need help. Very raw, emotive sort of terms. But anyone working in mental illness can probably relate to this. But the problem is, if you're working with people suffering from depression, or men especially who are suffering from depression, they are already at a point where they're ready to talk to you. That's a huge way down the track. A lot of these men aren't willing to talk to anyone. And that's why they are hiding online, often in public forums with anonymous voices, trying to get some support. And a lot of these men are supported online by other anonymous people. Okay? We don't know if they're men or women. We don't know if they're psychological counselors. We don't know if they're psychiatrists. They could just be everyday people. And a lot of the support that comes from these online communities is founded on the idea that people can help people, even if they're not face-to-face. Now, one of my colleagues, Nilakant here, posted something on Facebook the other day that a 20-second hug releases the same sort of hormones and dopamine associated with falling in love. And so a 20-second hug with someone can actually revive you and make you feel happier. And I said, my 2-second hugs with my colleagues are going to go up by a factor of 10. And every time they start to get a bit antsy about me hugging them for too long, I'm just going to whisper in their ear, shh. Science says this is good for us. Okay. And I think he responded with, look forward to your harassment suit or something like that. It's not very easy for a guy to hug each other. It's not very easy for a guy to go up and say something personal to them. That's not to say that guys don't need to. And this is showing that guys need to. Now, I'm not saying that this is brand new because of the internet. I think it's just because the internet is easier to find. Men will express themselves in different ways, and they will find ways to express themselves with the internet. We can see this, and we can use this to understand how people are suffering with depression. So there's certain difficulties with the work I do. I'm sure you guys all know this one up here, the Ghost Chips ad. Ghost Chips ad was a fantastic ad in my mind because it was different again. It was a different way of looking at a common problem, that is young men drinking drunk, driving drunk. Okay? What it did, it used humor. It used a lot of catchphrases. It used a lot of things that will actually relate to young men, especially of this socioeconomic background. So we were talking about this in class a couple of days ago, and a lot of people say, yeah, Monique thinks you're dumb, okay, is a common catchphrase. I can't eat your ghost chips. Spoon, egghead, spacehead is the other one. All these things that people remember. Not violent. No use of fear. No use of death. No use of maiming. But it was still able to cut through. But then we had another group of people that said, you know, that was really cringeworthy. I didn't like looking at that because it made me think that New Zealand is going to be perceived as X, Y, and Z. It's gone viral, and people in England think this is what our parties are like. I'm like, I'm pretty sure that's what my parties were like. I don't know. It was played during the Rugby World Cup, and there's visitors who, oh. Some people felt it was stereotypical. Some people said it was racist. It is very difficult to please everyone, because everyone's got an opinion about what you're talking about. Not many people care that much about what you eat for dinner. Not many people care that much about what brand of chocolates you eat. If anyone's had any LMP chocolate, please give it to my wife. She's looking for it. She can't find it. It's driving me mad, okay? So if you got some, give it to my wife. Everyone has an opinion, and therefore you will always hear negative voices, even if you're doing the right thing. And so as a social marketer, you might come against opposition that way. And social marketing and TCR are focused more on changing a person's life and ideals than not things people like to change. Who are you to tell me what I should do? This is my life. Who are you to tell me how I should live my life? I'm a free person. I can do what I want. Okay? I remember I did a project once where I was sent to Fiji and I was told to change the culture of Fiji when it comes to eating. And I kind of, as politely as I could, but with a lot of swear words, said, I'm not going to go to another country and change a culture. But I can help you understand the culture of eating, and from there we can put something together that will be useful to the people of Fiji to encourage them to eat healthier. However, a lot of people are saying, this is how we live. How dare you come in and say, look, savages, the white men are here to tell you how to live better. Not very easy. And one of the barriers we face is social marketing as a result of that, and transform to consumer research. That's why starting with the population, working with them at the grassroots level, and finding out what motivates them and what drives them is, in my mind, far more important than actually saying, right, we got to stop people smoking. Right, tell them it's bad. Great idea. We got to stop people drinking. Okay, put the price up. Okay, that'll solve the problem. No. Talking to people. Finding out why they drink, finding out why they smoke, finding out the culture they live in, finding out ways we can use that community as a way of building bridges rather than building barriers between people. And a lack of funding means we are sometimes forced to be creative rather than effective. Now, this ad down here on the bottom here is called the most beautiful seatbelt ad in the world. And if you haven't seen it, go onto YouTube and Google most beautiful seatbelt ad in the world. And it has this amazing cinematography as this person has this crash simulated in their living room as their family protects them, blah, blah, blah. Beautiful cinematography, great filming, had zero effect. It went viral. A lot of people watched it. But people don't really think that way when they're getting in their car and they don't wear their seatbelt. What are the reasons people don't wear their seatbelt? Understanding who they are, understanding their lives they live, it's going to be far more important than finding a sexy ad. Unfortunately, because we have limited budgets, we rely on advertising houses giving us some pro bono work. When you take pro bono work from an advertising company, they said, well, we're going to do what we want to do, and this is our excuse to be as creative, as sexy as we can, and not really think about what might be effective. Now, that's not always the case, but it can sometimes be the case. I want to leave you with a couple of quotes, and this is one of my quotes from myself. Being irrelevant can often do more damage to your cause than doing nothing at all, doing anything at all. Being irrelevant doesn't mean that people will ignore you. You might actually put back your cause. If you're irrelevant, not only are you going to be pushing people away, but they might not listen to you again in the future. So being relevant, understanding the people you work with, walking a mile in their shoes, and trying to find something that will make an impact in their lives has got to come before anything else. Because as soon as you send something out that's irrelevant, you are going to be putting up barriers that are going to make it harder for you in the future. What can we do? Continue to work in the area in spite of inherent difficulties. Continue to focus on people we're trying to help and get to know them, and accept you cannot change everything and everyone. People often say how brave I am. People often say, well, that's very gutsy of you to do this sort of work. You know, it's very difficult to publish in this area. And I seem to think, well, I do care about publishing in this area. It's important for my career. I've got kids to feed and things like that. But at the same time, just because it's difficult doesn't mean we shouldn't try. And I like this quote from Mother Teresa. If you can't feed 100 people, just feed one. Feed just one. You might not be able to change the world, and that's okay. But you might be able to change the world for one person. You might be able to change the world for one person. So if you cannot feed everyone, if you cannot change everybody's life, then maybe just change one person's life. Sit down with them, hold their hand, work it out, see what matters to them. After a while, it becomes easier as you get to know people better. And the last quote that I use is from this guy, another Indian like myself. Similar haircut, as you can tell. First they ignore you, then they laugh at you, then they fight you, then you win. I get into trouble a lot. Not always through the university, that happens occasionally. But I get into trouble a lot because people get annoyed at what I'm doing, because I'm killing profits sometimes. I'm encouraging people to do things that maybe is not good for McDonald's business, or it's not good for British and American Tobacco, or whoever it might be. And so people, at first they ignore me, laugh at me. When they start fighting back, when they start telling me to cease and desist, I know I'm getting there. When they start telling me that you're never going to achieve anything, you're a worthless piece of crap, I know I'm getting there. When one tobacco company told me to check my car when I went home, I know I'm getting there. I still check my car. You get in trouble for doing work that is beneficial to society, because whenever you go against something that is trying to make money, people start losing money and start losing jobs. And sometimes, even if you're doing the right thing, even if you're trying to make the world a better place, you might come against people who are fighting you. Sometimes they're the big giants. A lot of the time they might be the people you're working with. When someone tells you to get lost because they don't want to hear from you, whatever it might be, they're kind of ignoring you. When they laugh at you, you're nearly there. When they start fighting you and they actively listen to you but they're fighting back, you know you're nearly there. So keep that up. That's all I have to say.